As the sun rose that morning on the day of Job's trials, he rose up to serve God as any other day. Bound and determined to live in God's favor, and nothing would stand in his way. Then the messengers came one by one with their story. In just a few moments, Job lost all he had. Great wealth and riches, the health of his body, even his children were dead. Back the tears in his eyes, he said, "The Lord give me, take away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. I served him before and I'll serve him today. Blessed be the name of the Lord."
This morning, I'm glad that the Lord has passed through and cut down a honey tree, allowed you and I just to feast at his table, to enjoy his blessings. Aren't you glad that we have a God that we can come to and bring our burdens to, Bible says that the Lord spoke and said, come unto me, all you that labor are heavy laden. It's an invitation that was given 2,000 years ago that extends to 2013, this very day. Whatever need you have, he's able to take care of it. I'm telling you, he may not come exactly when we call him, but he'll come on time, and he'll do what needs to be done. He's God. Beside him, there is none other. None other that you and I can turn to. None other that can help us like he can. Oh, it's good to be here this morning. Appreciate he, the Holy Spirit, that just chose to pass by our way, sweep through this congregation. I tell you, he's breathed on me this morning. I hope he has you. Remember when Jesus said to the disciples, was there with the disciples, and the Bible says he breathed on them. Oh, it's good to get that breeze from Beulah. Good this morning. Good to be in God's house. If you're visiting with us today, we want to welcome you in the name of our Lord. And Batley Baptist Church extends to you every courtesy that we can just to make you feel welcome. And I hope today that you've come to worship him. Let me just say, if this makes you uncomfortable, people worshiping the Lord and serving the Lord, this may not be the place for you. Because I'm determined that I'm not going to wait till I get to heaven to rejoice in what God's done for me. And I'm excited now. Somebody said, I'll get excited then. I'm excited now because I know where he brought me from, what he's done in my life. And when he sweeps through like he has this morning, I just want to get in on it. And so I hope that you've enjoyed what God has already done and anticipating what God's going to do. I'm going to ask
the midnight, I have oft hid my face, while the storms howl above me, and there's no hiding place. In the crash of the thunder, precious Lord, hear my over, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky. Say. until this storm passes by.
The Bible says that the Lord hath his way in the whirlwind and in the storm. Appreciate that, Debbie. You have your Bibles, Galatians chapter 2 and verse number 20. While you're turning there, I want to make this announcement. Choir is going to be singing in Dandridge on Tuesday night. That starts at 7 o'clock. Be a tent meeting. If you've never been to a tent meeting, it'd be a good time to go and find out what that's all about. I was raised in a time of tent meetings. My dad used to preach a lot of tent meetings, and there's just something special about it. And I also want to say this, if you'd like to ride the church bus, if you'll just, I'm going to ask Kathy to put a piece of paper back on the information desk, and if you'd like to ride the church bus, we'll take it if we get enough people to ride it. We'll give the choir the first priority on that, of course, but many of them have said that they're going to be driving, so we'll probably have room for several other folks, up to 14 people plus the driver. But be sure to sign up for that. And then I want to also say this, something God has laid on my heart, and looking probably at September, I'm going to be getting, I've contacted Don Pearson. He's a prayer strategist. That's a fancy title for a preacher. And I've never heard anybody like him. And I've heard a lot of preachers over the years, but never heard anybody preach on prayer like he does. Every time I've been around him in meetings, there was never a time when they had to wait till the invitation was given. While he's preaching, folks are coming to the altar. Just a powerful man of God. And I'm going to try to get him to come in September, the first, or maybe the second Sunday in September. And then on those Monday nights in September, at least what I'm looking at right now, this is all tentative. In Monday nights in September, we're going to have our Monday night meetings. And I'm going to invite some great men of God on Monday nights to come in and preach to us. We're going to have some good singing, and just I'm going to work with Lee on this. We're going to get this together. He didn't even know about it. I'm just now telling him. But I'm so excited about this. God has burdened my heart to do this for some time. So we're going to start out on Sunday learning how to pray, how to find the Lord in times of need. And then we're going to start on that Monday night following, and every Monday night thereafter in the month of September, Lord willing, we're going to have a meeting here at the church. And so I want you to go ahead, mark on your calendar. I'm giving you plenty of warning, notice, I guess would be a better word, plenty of notice so that you don't schedule anything. I didn't do it. I'm not going to do it on Labor Day weekend because I know a lot of you are going to be gone that weekend, so we'll start the next weekend. But we just really need to get in touch with God. And so I believe this will be a great help to us. If you've turned to Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20, or even if you haven't, stand with me this morning as we read God's Word together. Galatians 2, verse number 20. Paul writes to the church at Galatia. He said, I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Father, I thank you this morning for your precious word. Use me, Lord, as your instrument that I might proclaim, Lord, these wonderful truths. And help us, Lord, to grasp what you say to us, to hide your word in our hearts. Lord, to draw closer to you. And Father, we'll give you praise and thanksgiving in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. I'm going to ask that this morning that you give me your undivided attention. If you can help it, don't leave the building. Let's just be real sensitive to the Holy Spirit because he's very easily distracted. And I believe I've got a message that God wants me to preach today. And I know I need it. I've preached to myself before I preach to you. And so this morning, if you can help me with that, I'd be most appreciative. I was reading about people that have tried to crucify themselves. And I found a couple of cases. In order to draw attention to world peace, in 1973, a man by the name of Patrice Tamayo of the Dominican Republic, he allowed himself to be crucified. And in that country, they televised it. Thousands and thousands of people watched as he was nailed to a cross. They took three stainless steel nails, 6 inches long, and they nailed him to a cross. He intended to stay there for 48 hours, but in 20 hours they had to take him down because he had developed an infection. A lot of folks have tried to do that. In 1965, Daniel Wasna of Kenya, he compelled his wife to crucify him, according to his words, for the sins of all the Kenyans. What he didn't know is the sin debt's already been paid. And so he allowed her to crucify him. And after she reluctantly obeyed him, she fell dead from shock. Later, they had to take him down from the cross because he also developed an infection, but he died just a short time after that. Now, that's not what Paul is talking about in chapter 2 and verse 20 of the book of Galatians when he said, "I am crucified with Christ." He's not talking about physical crucifixion. He's not talking about us being nailed to the cross. So what does Paul mean when he writes these words? Well, I believe, first of all, he is saying, "I am crucified with Christ because he died for my sins." In the book of Isaiah, chapter 53, verse 5 and 6, it says, "But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray and turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all." And so this morning, Paul was saying, "I'm crucified with Christ because he died for my sins." Paul also writes in 1 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse number 3. He said, "I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures." And then in Galatians chapter 1, verse 3 and 4, he writes, "Grace be to you and peace from God the Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins." As we look upon the crucifixion scene, we see three crosses. The man in the middle, none other than the Lord Jesus Christ. Two thieves on either side. But I want you to know, dear friend, in the mind of God, you and I were also there. The Bible teaches us that knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin, for he that is dead is freed from sin. I tell you, when I got saved by the grace of God, in the mind of God, I was crucified with Christ. The old man was put to death. And that's exactly what Paul is talking about in Romans chapter 6 and verse number 6, knowing that the old man is crucified with him. Then he goes on to write in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17, that if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Why? Because the old man is dead. The old man has been crucified. That song, "Thanks to Calvary," says, "Today I went down to the place where I used to go. Today I saw the same old crowd I knew before. And when they asked me what had happened, I tried to tell them, thanks to Calvary, I don't come here anymore. Thanks to Calvary, I'm not the man I used to be. Thanks to Calvary, things are different than before. As the tears ran down my face, I tried to tell them, thanks to Calvary, I don't live here anymore." What he is trying to say in that song is the old man is dead. Like the Apostle Paul was trying to say, because of Calvary, because the old man has been crucified, I'm glad that I've been made a new creature in Christ Jesus. I'm crucified with him because he died for my sins. I'm crucified with him because, secondly, he died in my stead. In other words, he took my place on Calvary. A beautiful picture of Calvary in the Old Testament is in Genesis chapter 22, where God commanded Abraham to take his son, his only son Isaac, up to Mount Moriah. And he said, "I want you to take him there and give him as a burnt offering." Abraham obeyed. The Bible says that he went to Mount Moriah, and they provided. They gathered the wood for the fire. They gathered the stones to set up the altar. And Isaac said to his father, he said, "Father, I see the wood, but where is the sacrifice?" And I love what is said in that scripture. Abraham said, "God," now listen to this very carefully. It doesn't say God will provide for himself a lamb, but it says this: God will provide himself a lamb. Now there's a big difference. God will provide himself a lamb. Jesus Christ, when he came in beginning his ministry, John the Baptist looked up and said, "Behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world." When Jesus Christ went to the cross, God died on that cross. God provided himself a lamb. He was the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. Oh, I love that scripture. I'm glad this morning that God took my place, aren't you? We don't have to die on a cross. I'm telling you, God has already paid the price through his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Everything that needs to be done has been done. That's why it caused Jesus to cry from the cross. One of the seven sayings from the cross is this: "It is finished." The debt's paid in full. Tetelestai, the Greek word. I'm telling you, that was given to a slave that had been set free. It was given to a prisoner that had paid the debt. And Jesus was saying this: "You're now free because of the payment. I'm dying in your place." Prison doors have been opened. And now because of me, whom the Son has made free, is free indeed. Oh, I was guilty with nothing to say, and they were coming to take me away, when a voice from heaven was heard that said, "Let him go. Take me instead." And I should have been crucified. I should have suffered and died. Oh, but dear friend, I should have hung upon the cross in disgrace. But Jesus, God's Son, took my place. By the way, that'd be a good place for a shout. Be a good place for an amen right there. That he would take our place, die in our stead. I'm crucified with Christ because he died for my sins, because he died in my stead. And I'm crucified with Christ through the denial of myself, my denial of myself. The Bible says in Luke 9:23, our Lord spoke and said this, and he said to them, "If any man will come after me, let him take up his cross daily and follow me." I'm crucified whenever I take up my cross. Oh, I'm glad this morning that you and I that are saved, the old man is dead. But I'm telling you, as long as we live in the flesh, every day this has to be put to death. That's what Paul was talking about when he said, "I die daily." He was saying the old man is crucified every day. Every day as I choose to follow him, every day that I take up my cross, I'm crucified with him, and I'm going to deny myself and let the old man die the death that he deserves. I'm crucified with Christ through my death to sin. Listen to what the Bible says in Colossians 3:5. Mortify means put to death. Put to death your members that are upon the earth: fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil, conspicuous, a covetousness, which is idolatry. Mortify, put to death your members which are in the flesh. You know what that means? That means that my hands are to be put to death. My ears are to be put to death. My eyes are to be put to death. My feet are to be put to death. My mind is to be put to death. All of the members in my flesh every day are to be mortified or put to death. I'm to reckon myself as dead every day. Members of my body. I'm telling you this morning, there's some things in my life and in your life that need to be crucified. The members of our bodies. My feet and my hands need to be crucified. My hands need to be crucified. The Bible says that Jesus' hands were crucified. Listen to what the psalmist said: "They pierced my hands and my feet." they were crucified on the cross. His hands and his feet were crucified. You know what that means? Paul said, mortify your members of your body. That means that my hands and my feet are to be crucified every day. And when they're crucified, my hands are able to reach out to a lost and dying world. When my hands become his hands, because my hands have been crucified, I'm able to reach out. I'm able to hug and not harm. I'm able to hold and not hit. I'm telling you, when we allow him to crucify our hands, we can use these hands to reach out to those that need Jesus and to reach out to others that need to be encouraged. My feet are to be crucified every day. Mortify the members in your body. My feet need to be crucified so that now I can go where God wants me to go. I can follow his directions. Bible says, in all thy ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. The only way, though, that he'll direct your path, you got to crucify your feet. Your feet can't carry you where you used to go, to do the things that you used to do. Feet now have to carry you to the house of God. They have to carry you to a world that is lost and in need of a Savior. And then his will was crucified. I'm wondering if we're allowing our will to be crucified. Remember what Jesus said, Father, if thou be willing, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. Jesus crucified his own will on Calvary, came to do the Father's will. Bible says in Philippians chapter 2, verse number 8, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. His will was crucified. I wonder if our will is crucified. I wonder if we can truly say, not my will, but thy will be done. The only way you can say that is to crucify your own will. Amen. And to take on yourself the will of the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. His will was crucified. And then his ears were crucified. You remember how that they mocked him on the cross? They scorned him. They cursed him. It's amazing. There's no reference to that he even listened to what they were saying. Why? Because he was putting his ears to death. But I'm glad that he did hear the cry of a repentant sinner. Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. And Jesus said, verily, verily, I say unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. His ears were put to death. I'm wondering if we've crucified our ears. I tell you one way to know. I thought about this, and I'll make mention of it a little bit more in just a second. I thought about gossip. There would be no gossipers if there was no listeners. Now just chew on that for a few minutes till I get down to what I'm going to say. Our tongues need to be crucified. His tongue was crucified. I'm telling you, the Bible talks about how that it stuck to the roof of his mouth because he was so dehydrated. His tongue was crucified. Oh, I'm glad this morning that you and I, that we can have our tongues crucified. I see a lot of folks have piercings, and I'm not going to get into that this morning. But I don't know how, in the name of common sense, that anybody could allow somebody to put a hole in their tongue. I remember a few years ago, I went to the dentist, and he was working on a tooth. And when I got done, he gave me pain medicine. He had never given me pain medicine before. But let me just rephrase that, my former dentist. He never gave me pain medicine before, and I wondered why. And, of course, you know how you are when your mouth is full of Novocaine. You know what I'm talking about, don't you? You can't feel nothing, and you don't even feel like you got a lip. Or a tongue. But I tell you, when the feeling came back in, I found out why he gave me pain medicine. That drill that they used had got loose from him, and it put a big hole in my tongue. But when the feeling came back, I thought the top of my head was coming off. And so I just want to tell you this morning, I'm going to crucify my tongue, but I am not going to pierce my tongue. I've done had it pierced. But our tongue is to be crucified. the tongue that gossips needs to be nailed to the cross. Heard about a lady that came to the pastor and she said, "Preacher, I'm under conviction." He was preaching about the use of the tongue. She said, "I want to lay my tongue on the altar." And he said, "Ma'am," said, "we've just got 30 feet of altar, but do the best you can." How crucified is your tongue this morning? Have you put it to death so that it doesn't speak evil? It doesn't speak cursings? It's not critical? I wonder this morning why some folks come to church. You know, if you come looking for boogers, guess what? You're going to find them. We're all imperfect. And if you're looking for fault, you'll find fault. But if you come looking for a blessing, dear friend, you'll find a blessing. And one of the ways that I'll say this morning that you can know whether or not you come to criticize or you come to seek a blessing, if what we've already been able to experience, if it didn't stir in your soul, then you're probably here for the wrong reason. And so we're to put our tongues to death. Jesus' tongue was crucified. His eyes were crucified. I think about him as they put that crown of thorns upon his head after they had beat him to the point that Isaiah said he was marred more than any man. Couldn't even recognize him. I'm sure that as they beat him in the face that his eyes had swelled shut. I'm sure that as that blood ran down from that pierced brow, that blood, as it dried in his eyes, that it matted his eyes. His eyes were crucified. Well, I tell you this morning, our eyes need to be crucified. They need to be put to death. Oh, to the images that the world sends to us. The Bible talks about the lust of the eyes in 1 John. Dear friend, the only way to take care of that problem is to put it to death. Put our eyes to death. Crucify our eyes, but then allow our eyes to be open to the needs of a lost and dying world, to those that are hurting. Our eyes, after they've been crucified, need to be open to that. And then Jesus' mind was crucified, took upon himself the mind of a servant, of humility. I'm talking about the King of Glory. The Bible tells us in Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 through 8, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who thought himself, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon himself the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in the fashion of men, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross." My mind, like his, needs to be crucified. Paul goes on to write, he said, "Whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, think on these things." In other words, we're to fill our mind with the things of God. Instead of the pollution of the world, is our mind crucified with Christ? I wonder how often we think about him. I wonder how often we think about what he has left us here to do. And then last of all, his affections were crucified. Affections. Jesus' incarnation demonstrates his affection for his Father and for all humanity. When he goes to the cross, he declares his allegiance to his Father. This morning, where are your affections? The word affections means desires. Where are your desires this morning? Where are your treasures laid up? Jesus said in Matthew 6, 19 and 20, "Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon the earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt and where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt and where thieves do not break through and steal." I wonder where your affections are. If they're on the things of the world, then dear friend, it's a good sign that your affections need to be crucified so that you can have the affections of our Savior. Colossians chapter 3, verse 2 and 3 says, "Set your affections on things above, not on things of the earth." Listen to this. "For ye are dead, and Your life is hid with Christ in glory. I wonder if we've put the members of our body to death. Have our hands been put to death? You see, these are not my hands anymore. Know you not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which you have of God? You're not your own anymore. You've been bought with a price. That means I don't belong to me anymore. I belong to Him. And if I belong to Him, that means these are not my hands. These are His hands. These are not my feet. These are His feet. These are not my ears. They're His ears. These are not my eyes. These are His eyes. If I've been put to death, crucified with Him, and that means this is not my mind, it's His mind. And the affections that I have are not my affections anymore. They're His affections. In other words, I now love the things that He loved. I'm going to ask Him to come and lead us in a song of invitation. I wonder today if you'll just look at your life just for a moment, put everything else away just for a moment, and think about your life. Are you dying daily? Have you crucified the old man? Do you do that on a daily basis? I know when you're saved, the old man's crucified. I tell you, the old flesh rises up every day. We have to put him to death over and over and over again. Somebody said, not me. If the Apostle Paul had to do it, I guarantee you have to do it. Put him to death. Let him be crucified afresh every day. This man, not Jesus, but us, our bodies, our flesh. Let it once again be nailed to a cross each day. Die daily, take up our cross daily, and follow him. Let's stand as we sing together.
Search me, oh God, and know my heart today. Try me, oh Savior, know my thoughts, I pray.
You need to come and talk to the Lord. You're welcome this morning. Don't let anything hinder you. Whatever the need is, bring it to Him. Let me say this before you sing that next verse. That you and I, if we find ourselves not as close to God as we was maybe a few days ago or a few weeks ago, that means that we're drifting. And a course correction is needed immediately. You don't want to wait until you're shipwrecked upon the shores of sin. You don't want to wait until tragedy has come because of your disobedience. You find yourself, preacher, I'm just not as close to God as I used to be. I just don't feel His presence like I once did. And I tell you this morning, you ought to come quickly. You ought to say to the Lord, Lord, I'm giving you my body to be crucified. I'm crucifying my will. I'm coming to you so I can draw close to you. I tell you, it's no disgrace to come to an altar and say that to the Lord, because all of us, if Paul died daily, Paul said, I have to do that every day of my life. But maybe it's been a few days, maybe several days, or even weeks since you've come and allowed the flesh to be crucified so that you could rise in that newness of life once again. I'm going to ask you to come as we sing another verse of the song. Will you do that?
Lord, take my life.
If you need to come, don't be ashamed to come. Don't be ashamed to bring it to the Lord and lay it down at His feet.
Feel my poor heart with Thy great love divine.
I know there's others.
Jesus. Don't be ashamed to come and say, Lord, I want to draw close to you. Now, I'm just not as close as I want to be. I want to draw near to you this morning.
Heard a man this week, and he said this. He said that he was out of the will of God, that he wanted the Holy Spirit to speak to him, to draw him back to God. If he belongs to the Lord and he's out of the will of God, he doesn't have to wait for God to speak. It's not God that left. And if you're out of the will of God this morning, you don't have to wait for any signal from heaven. That's not going to be given. But I tell you what can happen if we confess our sins. He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins, and he'll cleanse us from all of our unrighteousness. If we've left him, it's our move to come back to him. Now, I know in the matter of salvation that he draws us. I understand that. And I know the Holy Spirit deals with us in conviction when we're out of the will of God. But you don't have to wait on a special time to get back where the Lord wants you to be. Today is your day. We're going to sing one more verse of a song. This song's for you that have just lingered and you've waited. Now's your opportunity. I pray that you don't squander it.
Search me, oh God.
Appreciate this service this morning. What a wonderful meeting we've had with the Lord today and with each other. And I hope you'll come back and be with us tonight. We start at 6 o'clock. And Wednesday nights, we start at 7 o'clock. And you're invited to any and all those services. But we do appreciate you being here today, especially if you're visiting. Again, I want to say to you, we're so glad that you chose Batley to come to. He's got something to say. I'm always afraid when them boys won't speak, but
Chad's not over, he's in Children's Church. But just as a announcement purpose, next Sunday we're going to have a chili supper after the Sunday morning service. Now the chili is free, and we need all the ladies in church to try to make a chili that can make me cry. All right, make it hot. All right, that's the only way to eat chili. But after that, we're going to have a Cakes for Camp, and that's a fundraiser for the teenagers that are going to camp. And that's going to help us pay for their camp trip. And so we need you to make chili, and we need you to make camps. And then when we get over there, you need to bid high on those camps so we can send those kids to camp. So don't forget that. Huh? Cakes. Make cakes. It's obviously, there's a reason the dad was scared when I walked up here. I'm not as gifted with my words as he is, so... But just remember that goes to a good thing. And let me tell you right now, that week in camp can be life-changing for that teenager. It can be life-changing. So just remember that.
I do appreciate that announcement. I went down there a couple of years ago, and they're not going down there to play all the time. They've got activities, but every day, a couple of times a day, they're going to be preached to. Great men of God that are going to preach the Word of God to them and help them. And it'll be a big benefit to our church when they come back. And so if you can help with that, well, that'd be appreciated. I do want to correct him with one thing. It's not a supper. It's dinner. It's dinner. Supper will be when you go home after church. God bless you. Hope to see you this evening.